And it's lovely that welcome you all here this morning. It's lovely, just such a lovely bright morning after all the rain last night. I thought that I was going to be having to come out in a boat this morning down to the tunny and up here. The rain was so heavy last night. And also, just in case anybody is confused, it's just been pointed out to me that I was obviously a bit confused whenever I was putting the presentation together. Today is not the 25th of October. It is the 29th of October. So yeah, I hadn't. And let's just say that nobody in the tunny noticed that one either. So, you know, you can read into that what you may. So as we come this morning, just a few verses from the Psalm appointed for today, Psalm 90, just to focus our minds on why we're here. And verses say, Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the whole world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. So the Lord be with you. We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, and to pray for the needs of the world, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. O Lord, open our lips. Let us worship the Lord. So we stand and sing our first hymn, Immortal, Invisible. So let's stand and sing.
Thank you.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So let us kneel and confess our sins to God, our Father. And we join together saying, O God, our loving Father in heaven, we confess that we have sinned against you. We have broken your commandments. We have often been selfish, and we have not loved you as we should. For these and all our sins, forgive us, we pray, through our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And may the love of God bring us back to himself, forgive us our sins, and assure us of his eternal love in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we've got our first Bible reading, so thanks, Stephen.
You know, brothers, that our visit to you was not a failure. We had previously suffered and been insulted in Philippi, as you know, but with the help of our God, we dared to tell you his gospel in spite of strong opposition. For the appeal we make does not spring from error or impure motives, nor are we trying to trick you. On the contrary, we speak as men approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. We are not trying to please men, but God who tests our hearts. You know we never use flattery, nor did we put on a mask to cover up greed. God is our witness. We were not looking for praise from men, not from you or anyone else. As apostles of Christ, we could have been a burden to you, but we were gentle amongst you, like a mother caring for her little children. We loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well, because you had become so dear to us. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thanks, Stephen. Pardon? There is a hymn between them.
Okay. The next reading is from Matthew 22, verses 34 to 45. And you can find it on page 991 in the Pew Bible, the Greatest Commandments. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, "What do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he?" "The son of David," they replied. He said to them, "How is it then that David, speaking by the Spirit, calls him Lord? For he says, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet.' If then David calls him Lord, how can he be his son?" No one could say a word in reply, and from that day on, no one dared to ask him any more questions. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thanks, Stephen. So we're going to stand now and sing our next hymn, Blessed Assurance. It's 59 in Mission Praise, are the words on the screen. So let's stand and sing. And we take our seats again. Lord, take my words and speak through them, and take our ears and minds to hear what you want to say to each one of us this morning. I'll try to remember that there's people behind me. In any good story, we love to see our hero win the upper hand. And at a basic level, that is what we see in Matthew's telling of the encounter between Jesus and the Pharisees. It's somewhat humorous and also very satisfying in this masterclass in how to deal with your critics. And this section of Matthew tells us how the various factions in Israel were trying to trap Jesus, seeking to tie him up in knots and to get him to condemn himself and his teachings by his own words. And we saw last Sunday how they had tried unsuccessfully to trap him with a political question about the payment of tax to the Romans. And this is followed in verses 23 to 33, the verses in between the two passages, by a different group, the Sadducees, trying to trip him up with a question about the resurrection. And again, Jesus' wise answer results in the crowds being astonished at his teaching. And you would think that the Pharisees would have learnt their lesson by now. But no, they're determined to continue with their one-upmanship. The Sadducees and the Pharisees disliked each other. And so the Pharisees were really delighted with Jesus' rebuff of their rivals. And now they thought that they could really get the upper hand and show their cleverness with a knockout strike against Jesus and the Sadducees in one simple move. Infighting between religious groups, unfortunately, it's not restricted to the Pharisees and the Sadducees, but continues in many guises within and between churches today. And it is never edifying. So the Pharisees get together to plan their next move, coming up with a real beezer wheeze, a question about the law. Surely this will trap Jesus and destroy him and seal their position of knowledge and authority. You can see their smugness a mile off. So they come to him again with another question. Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Given that there were more than 600 commandments in the law of Moses, with many debates between the rabbis about which were the strongest, this expert of the law who posed the question no doubt thought that this question would well and truly trap and entangle Jesus in this complex area of rules and regulations. But again, Jesus is not fazed, as he responds immediately with calmness, not getting riled, and also with great wisdom. His reply, so traditional that no one could challenge him, yet also so deeply searching that everyone would be challenged by it. And his response is straight from the Shema, the Jewish confession of faith, that would have been recited by devout Jews every morning and evening, and it's still recited today at the beginning of every synagogue service. The Shema, named after the first word of Deuteronomy 6, verse 4, hear, which continues, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. Jesus' answer is pure orthodoxy. However, he doesn't stop there. But again, quoting from the law set out in the Old Testament scriptures, he continues saying that this law doesn't stand on its own. Rather, there is a second like it. Love your neighbor as yourself, quoting from Leviticus 19, verse 18. Then concluding that all the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. All the teaching of God in the scriptures hang on these two commandments. There is nothing that the Pharisees can say. But Jesus doesn't leave it there. Rather, he turns the table on these so-called experts in the law, asking them a question about the Messiah. As Matthew knew, and as we know, the lovely irony of this is that it was the Messiah himself who was asking the question of the religious leaders. And you can just see the Pharisees spluttering and panicking as they try to answer, only to get well and truly tied up in knots. It really is quite wonderful and masterly. And as we see the Pharisees slink off, no one could say a word in reply. From that day on, no one dared to ask him any more questions. And we know that that was not the end of the matter, as the Pharisees turned to other ways to get rid of Jesus, this teacher who so humiliated them, showing up their hypocrisy and shallowness for the crowds to see. And Jesus knew that only too well. But this is more than simply an example of Jesus' ability to deal with his opponents, albeit an example that demonstrates wisdom and calmness, not an angry or defensive response. And it is an example that we can all learn from. But Jesus' response to the Pharisees' questions carries an important message, not just for the Jews of his day, but also for us today. An answer that moves beyond the rules, beyond the rigidity of striving to obey the minutiae of hundreds of rules and regulations, to describe something that is much more relational. Jesus' summary of the law takes the questioner and us away from the area of achievement, focusing on rigidly obeying and keeping the letter of the law, to one of attitude, focusing on and dependent on the Lord, a teaching that focuses on the heart. The first and greatest commandment, as summarized by Jesus in Matthew's Gospel, is love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. Or as Mark summarizes it, adding, and with all your strength. Whatever way you read it, Jesus is reiterating the original law that God gave his people, to love him with their whole being. We are to love the Lord with our heart, our emotions, with the very deepest part of who we are, our soul, our very spiritual essence, with our minds, our intelligence, and with our strength, powerfully, not weak or half-hearted, and also physically. This is an all-consuming love. But what does love mean? It's a word that can be used to cover a multitude of scenarios, from romantic love through to denoting our liking for something. I love hot sunny days. I love chocolate. It's a word that in many ways can be quite meaningless. The Greek language, the international language of the time in which the New Testament was written, had four words for love. There was eros, the love of physical desire and longing, and it's where we get the word erotic from. Then stergos, which meant was an affection, the mutual love between family members. And neither of these words are used in the New Testament. Then we have the third word, philos, which is the care and concern that friends would have for each other. And this is used occasionally in the New Testament. But it's the fourth word for love, agape, which is the one that is predominantly used in the Bible. And one commentary explains the meaning of agape as this. It says, it's a unique type of supreme love involving a conscious and deliberate choice to do good for another, a commitment based on the willful choice of the lover, not the qualities of the person receiving the love. It's a love that is perhaps most fully described by Paul in 1 Corinthians 13. And this is what Jesus means when he calls us to love in these verses. There's nothing weak or washy, soppy or sloppy in the love that we are called to have for God and for others. And it's important that Jesus didn't just say that the greatest commandment was to love the Lord, full stop. Yes, that would have answered the Pharisees' question, but it's only part of the picture. As Jesus says, the second greatest commandment is like it. That is, the two commandments go hand in hand. You can't have one without the other. As one commentator, Michael Green, says, what a marvelous definition of true religion this is. If there is real love for God, there will inevitably be real love for neighbour. God's overflowing love is infectious. The criterion of whether love for God is real is whether or not it is reflected in our relationships with others. As 1 John 4, verses 20 and 21 says, whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother and sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. And he has given us this command, anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. This command to love our neighbour is reflected throughout the Bible. In the New Testament, in both Jesus' direct teaching and in the advice and guidance of the letter writers to the new Christians, it is a subject that we constantly need to remind ourselves about. But the first and fundamental question is, who is my neighbour? A question that Luke tells us the expert in the law went on to ask Jesus. In response, Jesus told the story of the Good Samaritan, how the Samaritan man, an outsider, was the one to risk danger, inconvenience, and monetary expense, stopping to help the stranger in need, his neighbour. Our neighbour is not just the person living next door to us. It's not just those who are like us, or indeed those that we like to get on with. As the parable of the Good Samaritan highlights, our neighbour is anyone and everyone. Those we know, those we don't. Those we like, and those we don't. Even, dare it be said, those we might count as an enemy. It's a tall order. Then there's the question, what does this love look like? Yes, we can read the definition of love, but what does it mean in reality? 1 John 3, verse 18 puts it simply. Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. Love for our neighbour is practical. Fine words and platitudes simply won't or not enough. Yes, love is an attitude, but it must be backed up by action. Actions that can take many different forms depending on the situation and context. From donating money to an overseas appeal, giving groceries to the food bank, giving someone a lift, helping with a practical task, standing alongside someone or spending time with them. The list is endless. And love for our neighbour may cost us in time, convenience, or financially. It may mean that we help or spend time with someone that, truth be told, we don't particularly like or agree with. Nor is it enough to say, I don't do any harm to anyone. That simply won't wash. Loving our neighbour is deliberate and active. And the greatest example of this love? The love of God for us. As that famous verse in John 3, verse 16 tells us, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world. And as John writes later in his epistle, in his letter, this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. This is the measure of true love. Jesus, who willingly paid the ultimate price, giving his everything, not just for those who were his friends, but to redeem and save all who had sinned against him, against God, to give each and every one of us the opportunity of redemption. Such love, such costly love. But who of us can live up to this high standard of love? We all fall short. None of us are good enough. If we try to fulfill this law, to love God and love our neighbor, like the Pharisees, rigidly counting every letter of the law, doing it in our own strength and ability, we'll fail. Rather, we need to view these, the greatest of the commandments, not as orders to be obeyed in our own strength, but as an invitation to a new way of life, to change our attitudes, to accept his gift of love, and with God's grace, letting his love fill us and to share that love with the world around us. As we draw near to the Lord, spending time with him, allowing his love to fill us, so that we too love him with every part of our being. A love which, if true and heartfelt, will overflow to those around us. And more than that, asking the Lord to help us to love as he does, asking for his help to love our neighbour, including those we do not find it easy to love. It's a choice, a decision, and it doesn't necessarily come easy. God knows that we are human. We're not perfect, but that's not an excuse not to love. He has set us the example, and he gives us the resources. It will look different for each one of us, but we're all called to love God and to love our neighbor. If we say we love the Lord but don't love our neighbor, we've missed the point. God has not only given us the commandment, but he's the very embodiment of it. God's love through Jesus that was poured out for us in the most costly ways is our example and our resource. So Jesus' words were meant to challenge us, to shake us up, to disturb our thinking, but in the very best of possible ways. So let's reset ourselves to love God with every fibre of our being, showing and demonstrating that love in how we treat and respond to those in the world around us, to our neighbours. So we're going to stand and sing again our next hymn, My Jesus, which is 894, I think, in Mission Praise. So let's stand and sing. and we remain standing as we declare together what we believe in the words of the Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And if we take our seats as we come to our time of prayer. Let us pray. In the collect for today, the fifth Sunday before Advent. Blessed Lord, who caused all Holy Scriptures to be written for our learning, help us to hear them, to read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that through patience and the comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and forever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And as we make our intercessions to the Lord, if we make each prayer our own, joining in the response, after I say, God of love, responding with, hear us and help us. God of love, blessed are you, Lord, our God, for you love us with an everlasting love. We rejoice that nothing can separate us from your love in Christ Jesus. Lord, help us to show your love to each other at all times. Blessed are you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Loving God, we give thanks for the fellowship of the church, and for all who have taught us the faith. We pray for preachers and teachers, for evangelists and Bible translators. We pray for all who are challenged or questioned about their faith, especially in a public forum, that they would have wisdom, courage, and grace as they respond. And we ask that as a church, our love for you would spill over in demonstrable love towards our neighbors. God of love, loving God, you are the creator of all things, the most high ruler of all. We bring before you those who are in power across the world. May they listen to your guidance and wisdom to rule with justice and compassion. We remember this morning the many troubled parts of the world, places where power is abused, where injustice is pursued, where war and violence are prevalent, and ask for your comfort and blessing for those who suffer under those regimes. And we particularly bring before you the people of the Holy Lands, the Jewish people and the Palestinians, and we ask for your mercy. Be with those who are supporting those traumatized by acts of terror and violence, and those seeking to bring humanitarian aid and support to those caught in the middle of the fighting. And above all, we ask for hope and for peace. God of love, hear us and help us. Loving God, we give thanks for all who have shown us love and care. And we ask that you would be with those who, through paid work or volunteering, show your love in practical ways to the broken, the lonely, the homeless. We pray for our government and those in positions of authority and influence, nationally and locally, that they would make good decisions and use our public resources wisely to support and assist those in most need, irrespective of who they are. God of love, hear us and help us. Loving God, your compassion overflows beyond any boundaries of our imagination. We bring before you those who are working in the healing or caring professions and ask that you would encourage and strengthen them. And we bring before you this morning those who are ill or injured, naming them before you in the silence of our hearts. Anoint them with your healing grace. God of love, hear us and help us. And we bring all our prayers together as we join in the prayer that Jesus taught us, as we say together, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And just a couple of announcements before our final hymn. I think the only things that I'm aware of are walking group on Wednesday morning and the prayer meeting on Wednesday evening in the vicarage, which I think is at 7:30. But we'd encourage everybody to come. Prayer is such an important part of our parish. And for those who are involved in Coffee and Crack, there's a team meeting, not Coffee and Crack itself, but a team meeting on Tuesday morning. So those are the only things that I'm aware of, unless anybody else has anything else. No, is that next Sunday, the movie night? That's a good point. Yes, I think there's a movie night. The Advent series, which will be starting beginning of November, which I think is based on the film A Christmas Carol. And I think there's a movie night or showing the film, which I think is possibly next Sunday evening. So just bear that in mind. And no doubt it'll be further announced next Sunday morning. But I think, yeah, so I think that's right. Okay, so if we stand and sing our final hymn, which is Take My Life. So let's stand and sing.
Thank you.
as we join together in this final prayer as we go out. Be with us, Lord. Be with us, Lord, as we go out into the world. May the lips that have sung your praise always speak the truth. May the ears which have heard your word listen only to what is good. And may our lives as well as our worship be always pleasing in your sight, for the glory of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Almighty and merciful Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless us and keep us. Amen. We go in peace to love and serve the Lord. If you, everybody takes their seat again, and before we go this morning, Reverend Linda has asked the church wardens to make an announcement in each of the churches. So if you take your seats, and Stephen is.
So the notice is, the Right Reverend Jackie Cyril, Acting Bishop of Exeter, patrons and parish representatives are delighted to announce that, subject to the completion of the statutory formalities, an offer has been made for the post of team rector of the benefice of Dawlish with Holcombe, Coughton and Starcross, known as the Dawlish Coast Mission Community, to the Reverend Linda Cronin, who is currently rector of Glenavy Parish in the Diocese of Connor in the Church of Ireland. This offer has been accepted. Her licensing by the Acting Bishop of Exeter will take place in early 2024, on a date to be confirmed. So the upshot of that is Linda will be leaving us. Her and the family are moving back to England, to Devon, and her last time with us will be the end of January 2024.